Subject of physics of atom and atomic physics. Lecture number 9. Theme: solids, conductors and semiconductors. Lecture plan. First question: types of solids, band theory of solids. Second: electrical conduction in metals, the quantum free electron model. Third: the motion of electrons in a periodic lattice. Fourth, effective mass. In the gaseous state, the average distance between molecules is large compared to the size of a molecule, so the molecules may be regarded as isolated from one another. Many substances, however, are in the solid state at ordinary temperatures and pressures. In that state, molecules or atoms can no longer be regarded also isolated. Their separation is comparable to the molecular size, and the strength of the forces holding them together is of the same order of magnitude as the force binding the atoms into a molecule. Hence, the properties of a molecule are altered by the presence of the neighboring molecules. Characteristic of crystalline solids is the regular arrangement of atoms, a recurrent or periodic pattern called a crystal lattice. The solid can be regarded as a large molecule, the force between atoms being due to interaction between atomic electrons, and the structure of the solid being determined as that arrangement of nuclei and electrons which yields a quantum mechanically stable system. Also, the number of atoms involved is very large. They are arranged in a regular pattern. In non-crystalline solids, such as concrete and plastic, the perfectly regular pattern does not hold over long distances, but there is an orderly pattern in the neighborhood on any one atom. Crystalline solids are classified according to the predominant type of binding, the principal types being molecular, ionic, covalent, and metallic. Molecular solids consist of molecules which are so stable that they retain much of their individuality when brought in close proximity. The electrons in the molecule are all paired so that atoms in different molecules cannot form covalent bonds with one another. The intermolecular binding force is the weak van der Waals attraction that is present between such molecules in the gaseous phase. The physical mechanism involved in the van der Waals attraction is an interaction between the electric dipoles. Because of the fluctuating quantum mechanical behavior of the electrons in a molecule, all molecules have a fluctuating electric dipole moment. Even so, for many of them, symmetry considerations require that it fluctuate about on average the value of zero. At a time when a molecule has a certain instantaneous electrical dipole moment, the external electric field that is produced will induce in the charge distribution or nearby by molecule at dipole moment. By drawing rudimentary sketches of the charges and field in various cases, the student can immediately convince himself that the force exerted between the inducing and the induced electric dipole is always attractive. The interaction energy is proportional to the mean square of the inducing electric dipole moment. The resulting attraction is weak, the binding energies being of the order of 10 to minus 2 power electron volt, and the force varying with the inverse seventh power of the thermomolecular separation. In the solid, successive molecules have electric dipole moments which alternate in the orientation so as to produce successive attractions. Many organic compounds, inert gases and ordinary gases such as oxygen, nitrogen and hydrogen form molecular solids in the solid state. Because the binding is weak, solidification takes place only at very low temperatures, where the disruptive effect of thermal agitation are very small. The melting point of solid hydrogen is 14 Kelvin, for example. The weak binding makes molecular solids easy to deform and compress, and the absence of the free electrons makes them very poor conductors of heat or electricity. Ionic solids such as sodium chloride consist of close regular three-dimensional array of alternating positive and negative ions having a lower energy than the separated ions. The structure is stable because the binding energy due to the net electrostatic attraction exceeds the energy spent in transferring electrons to create as the isolate ions from neutral atoms, just as for ionic binding of molecules. Ionic binding in solids is not directional because spherically symmetrical closed shell ions are involved. Hence, the ions are arranged like closed packet spheres. The actual crystal geometry depends on which arrangement minimizes the energy, and thus this in turn depends principally on the relative sizes of the ions involved. Because there are no free electrons to carry energy or charge from one part of the solid to another, such solids are poor conductors of heat or electricity. Because of the strong electrostatic forces between the ions, ionic solids are usually hard and have higher melting points. Lattice vibrations can be excited by energies corresponding to radiation in the far infrared, so that ionic solids show strong optical absorption properties in that region. But optical absorption by excitation of electrons requires energy in the ultraviolet, so that ionic crystals are transparent to visible radiation. Covalent solids contain atoms that are bound by shared valence electrons as in covalent binding of molecules. The bonds are directional and determine the geometrical arrangement of atoms in the crystal structure. The rigidity of the electronic structure makes covalent solids hard and difficult to deform, and it accounts for their higher melting points. Because there are no free electrons, covalent solids are not good heat or electrical conductors. Sometimes, as for silicon and germanium, they are semiconductors. At room temperature, some covalent solids, such as diamond, are transparent. The energy required to excite their electronic states exceeds that of photons in the visible region of the spectrum, so that such photons are not absorbed. But most covalent solids absorb in the visible and are therefore opaque. Metallic solids exhibit a binding that can be thought of as a limiting case of covalent binding, in which electrons are charged by all the ions in the crystal. When a crystal is formed of atoms having a few weakly bound electrons in the outermost subshells, electrons can be freed from the individual atoms by the energy released in binding. These electrons move in the combined potential of all positive ions, and they are shared by all the atoms in the crystal. We speak of an electron gas interspersed between the positive ions and exerting attractive forces on each ion that exceed the repulsive forces of other ions, hence the binding. The atoms have vacancies in their outermost electron subshell, and there are no valence electrons per atom to form tight covalent bonds. The electrons are shared by all the atoms and are free to wander through the crystal from atom to atom, there being many unoccupied electronic states. In this sense, they behave like a gas. A metallic solid is a regular lattice of spherically symmetrical positive ions arranged like close packet spheres through which the electrons move. Metallic solids are obviously excellent conductors of electricity or heat. The electrons easily absorbing energy from incident radiation or lattice vibration and moving under the influence on an applied electrical field or thermal gradient. Because radiation in the visible portion of the electromagnetic spectrum is easily absorbed, such solids are opaque. All the alkalis form metallic solids. The type of binding that a particular solid has is determined experimentally by studies of X-ray diffraction, dielectric properties, optical emissions, and so forth. There are some solids whose binding must be interpreted as a mixture of the principal types we have described. In addition, not all solids have the ideal structure implied by the discussion so far. Indeed, the so-called lattice imperfections or deviations from ideal crystal structure lead to many properties of solids which have practical consequences. To understand the effect of putting a great many atoms close together in a solid, consider first two atoms only that are initially far apart. All of the energy levels of this two atom system have a twofold exchange degeneracy. That is, for the combined system, the space part of the eigenfunction for the electrons can contain either a combination of the individual atom space eigenfunctions, which is symmetric in the exchange of pairs of electron labels, or which is antisymmetric in such a label exchange. The total eigenfunction of the system of electrons is, of course, antisymmetric, since the symmetric space eigenfunction is associated with the antisymmetric spin eigenfunction, and vice versa. When the atoms are widely separated, the two different types of eigenfunctions lead to the same energy, and so each the energy levels is said to have a twofold exchange degeneracy. But when the atoms are brought together, the exchange degeneracy is removed, because the electron charge density in the important region between the atoms depends on whether the space eigenfunction is symmetric or antisymmetric. When the atoms are close enough together that the wave functions of the individual atoms overlap, the energy of the system depends on the symmetry of the space eigenfunction. Hence, a given energy level of the system is split into two distinct energy levels as overlap commences, and the splitting increases as the separation of the atom decreases. Of course, a famous example of this phenomenon is found in the ground state energy level of the system containing two hydrogen atoms. Earlier, this splitting was true for the ground state level only, but each of the higher levels of the system splits in the same way, and for the same reason as the atoms are brought together. If we had started with the three isolated atoms, we would have had a threefold exchange degeneracy of the energy levels. When the atoms are brought together in a uniform linear lattice, each of the levels splits into three distinct levels. Figure 1 illustrated this schematically for the typical energy level of a system of six atoms. The splitting commences when the center-to-center atomic separation R becomes small enough for the atoms to begin overlapping. As R decreases from this value, there is a decrease in the energy of the levels for which the symmetry of the space eigenfunction leads to a favorable electron charge distribution. It is which puts electron charge where the ion exerts the strongest binding, and in an increase in the energy of the levels associated with space eigenfunction, whose symmetry leads to an ultraviolet charge distribution. The more favorable or unfavorable the charge distribution is, the greater is the decrease or increase in the energy. So the levels are spread by the quantum mechanical requirements of indistinguishability about an average energy equal to the energy the system would have at a given R if there were no such requirements. Note that the average energy begins to increase rapidly for sufficiently small r. This is due to the Coulomb repulsion that the ions exert on each other. As we go to a system containing n atoms of a given species, each level of one of these atoms leads to n fold degenerate level of the system. When the atoms are well separated. With decreasing separation, each of these splits into a set of n levels. The spread in energy between the lowest and highest level of the particle set depends on the separation distance r. Since r specifies the amount of overlap that causes the splitting. But it does not depend significantly on the number of the atoms in the system, if the same separation distance is maintained. Thus, as more and more atoms are added in the system, each set of split levels contains more and more levels spread over about the same energy range at a particular R. At the values of R found in a solid a few angstroms, the energy spread is of the order of the few electron volts. If we then consider that the solid contains something like 10 to 23 power atoms per mole, we see that the levels of each set is in solid are so extremely close spaced in energy that they form a practically continuous energy band. The process we have just described is indicated in figure 2. We see from this figure that the low-lying energy levels are spread less than those that lie higher. The reason is that the electrons in low levels are electrons in inner subshells of the atoms, which are not significantly influenced by the presence of nearby atoms. These electrons are localized on particular atoms even when r is small, because the potential barriers between the atoms are for them relatively high and wide. The valence electrons, on the other hand, are not localized at all for small r, but they become part of the whole system. The overlapping of their wave functions results in a spreading of the energy levels. It should be pointed out that that is the level of an individual atom becomes a band of n levels, as does the 2s level, if we count in such as a way what each of these can accommodate two electrons of opposite spin. But the 2p level is triply degenerate in the space quantum number m sub l in the isolated atom, since m sub l can assume any of the values minus 1, 0, plus 1. Thus, the 2p level in the atom leads to 3n levels in the solid. As we shall discuss soon, this can be thought of as forming three bands of n levels, whose energy ranges may or may not coincide. Figure 2. Note that the lowest lying levels are not split appreciably because the atomic eigen functions for these levels do not overlap significantly. In figure 3, it is shown the band formation for the higher levels of sodium, whose ground state atomic configuration is 1s second, 2s second, 2p6, 3s1. Several general features of the allied bands, the continuous bands of energy levels for electrons, and forbidden bands, the regions where there are no electron energy levels, are illustrated in this figure. load bands corresponding to inner subshells such as second P in sodium are extremely narrow until the interatomic spacing becomes smaller than the value actually found in the crystal. As we go through the outer occupied subshells and into the unoccupied subshells of the atom in its ground state, however, the bands become progressively wider and a given interatomic separation. The reason is, again, that the greater the energy of the electrons are, the larger the regions in this which we can move and the more than affected to by nearby ions. As the energy increases, therefore, the successive allowed bands widen and overlap each other in energy. Figure number 3. The dashed line indicates the observed interatomic separation in solid sodium. The several overlapping bands that constitute each P or D band are not indicated. Direct experimental verification of energy bands comes from observation of X-ray spectra in solids. For example, the 3s2p transition in sodium gives the L-series X-ray line. A very sharp line spectrum is observed by gaseous sodium in which the 3s and second p levels are narrow. But the same X-ray lines from solid sodium are broadened because also the low-lying 2p level remains narrow, the 3s level has no become an energy band. The observed shape of X-ray lines from solids agrees with the energy band picture. Consider now the occupation of the energy levels. Those bands which originated in levels of closed subshell electrons of an isolated atom have all their level occupied. The bands that originated from a valence electrons may or may not be fully occupied. If an electric field is applied to the solid, the electrons will acquire extra energy only if there are available empty levels within the range of the energy the strength of the applied field allows the electron to gain. If there are no nearby empty levels, then the electron will not be able to gain any energy of all and the solid behaves like an insulator. What counts in determining the emphasis or fullness of the bands containing valence electron is the valence of the atoms forming the solid and the geometry of the crystal lattice into which are they solidify. An insulated band will be full of unit cell of the crystal lattice contains two valence electrons, one for each of the two possible values of the spin quantum number m sub l. Crystal structure geometry or crystallography is a complex subject that is very important in any detailed study of solid state physics. We shall restrict ourselves to no particular simple, usually one-dimensional crystal lattice. We shall, however, define a unit cell as the smallest geometrical arrangement of atoms that by periodic repetition along the coordinate axis can fully describe the geometrical arrangement for the atoms in the complete crystal. We shall also say that in a crystal lattice, some or all of the degeneracy of the atomic valence electron levels with respect to the quantum number m sub l is removed because these electrons are not in the spherically symmetrical potential of an atom in free space, but in the potential whose more complicated symmetry depends on the crystal geometry. For the reason, the three generated levels from a p subshell of a single atom led to three bands of n levels, each capable of holding two electrons in opposite spin in a crystal containing n of these atoms. These bands may be completely non-overlapping, partly overlapping, or completely overlapping in energy, depending on the crystal geometry. The term isolated band used the expressing the condition for the full band refers to a case in which these bands do not overlap each other, or bands from the other subshells. Then if there are two valence electrons per unit cell, each of the n levels in the lowest lying band will have its full complement of the two electrons. Note the quantity determining occupation is the number of the valence electrons per unit cell and not per atom. In a uniform one-dimensional lattice of identical atoms, such as we considered in the argument from each which they concluded that a band contains n levels. If the crystal contains n atoms, a unit cell contains one atom and there is no distinction to be made. When that argument is extended to three-dimensional crystal containing atoms of different species, it is found that the conclusion remains the same provided. N is the number of the unit cells in the crystal. Thus, if there are two valence electrons per unit cell, there will be two in each of the levels of the band, and the band will be fully occupied. The problem is predicting whether or not a solid is an insulator, is that the question of the band overlap is all important, and that this depends on details on the geometry of the crystal structure and of the geometry of the atomic eigenfunctions. If that, as far as valence is concerned, might have been a completely filled band actually overlaps what might have been a completely empty band, then there will be two partly filled bands. The result is that a solid that might have been an insulator will actually be a conductor. But it is at least possible to say that a solid can certainly not be an insulator unless one of its unit cells contains an even number of valence electrons, because an odd valence electron can never be in the filled band. Most covalent solids, like diamond, or ionic solids, like sodium chloride, are insulators. They all have an even number of valent electrons per unit cell. In diamond, each carbon atom has four valence electrons, and there are two atoms in each unit cell. The eight valence electrons per unit cell fully occupy the four multiplied n levels of four bands, one originating from the 2s subshell of the atom and three originating from the 3 2p subshells. These bands overlap each other, but they are well separated from empty higher energy bands. Sodium chloride contains the one sodium ion and one chlorine ion per unit cell, and the valence band consists of a set of completely filled bands that overlap each other but do not overlap unfilled bands. Alkali atoms like beryllium are divalent and form crystals with an even number of valence electrons per unit cell. But these solids are metals, not insulators, because overlapping bands make slightly higher unfilled levels energetically available to the electrons. In solids formed from the monovalent alkali atoms like sodium, the band containing the valence electrons cannot be filled, and so the solid behaves like a conductor. Only half of the levels of the isolated 3s allowed band of sodium are filled, because a sodium atom has a single electron in the 3s level, whereas the exclusion principle allows such a level to accommodate two electrons. Hence, electrons in the solid can easily acquire a small amount of additional energy. Thus, any applied electric field will be effective in giving electrons energy, and the solid will be a conductor. As we mentioned in the previous paragraph, conductors are also found in cases where bands containing valence electrons overlap. It is worthwhile putting the distinction between conductors and isolators into momentum instead to energy language. Without on applied electric field, there are as many electrons in the sodium with momentum vectors in the direction as there are with momentum vectors in the opposite direction, since there is no net current. When an electric field is applied, this equilibrium can be upset, causing a current to flow. If some of the electrons can go into quantum states with changed momentum vectors, this is quite possible for electrons in a partially filled band, but it cannot be done by electrons in completely filled band. At temperature above absolute zero, it is of course possible for some electrons to gain enough thermal energy to jump over the energy gap of a forbidden band of energy into a higher allowed band, thereby creating vacancies in the lower allowed band and making a new allowed band available. We speak of the nearly filled band as a valence band and the nearly empty band as a conduction band. The probability of this happening increases with temperature, and it depends strongly on the width of the forbidden band. Substances of this width of the energy gap is small are called semiconductors. One example is silicon, a covalent solid with a diamond-like structure, but with a forbidden band only about 1 electron volt wide. It becomes reasonably conducting at room temperature, so at low temperatures is an insulator. On the other hand, the gap between the filled and empty allowed bands is in diamond is about 7 electron volts. Thus, diamond is an insulator even at relatively higher temperatures. Some useful results concerning conduction electrons in metals can be obtained from classical ideas. In the absence of the applied electric field, the direction of which these electrons move is random. The reason is that the electrons frequently collide with imperfections in the crystal lattice of the metal, which arise from thermal motion of the ions about the equilibrium positions in the lattice, or from the presence of impurity ions in the lattice. In colliding with these imperfections, the electrons suffer changes in speed and direction, and this light makes their motion random. As in the case of the molecular collisions in a classical gas, we can describe the frequency of electron lattice imperfections collisions by a mean free path lambda, where lambda is the average distance that the electron travels between collisions. When an electric field is applied to a metal, the electrons modify their random motion in such a way that, on the average, they drift slowly in the direction opposite to that the field, because their charge is negative, with a drift speed V sub D. This drift speed is very much less than the effective instantaneous speed V of the random motion. In copper, V sub D is of the order of 10 to minus 2 power centimeter per second, whereas V is in the order of 10 to 8 power centimeter per second. The drift speed can be calculated in terms of the applied electric field E and of V and lambda. When a field is applied to an electron in the metal, it will experience a force of magnitude E multiplied E, which will give it an acceleration of magnitude A given by A equals E multiplied E divided M. Consider now an electron that has just collided with the lattice imperfection. In general, the collision will momentarily destroy the tendency to drift, and the electron will move in the truly random direction after the collision. Just before its next collision, the electron will have changed its velocity on the average by A multiplied lambda divided V, where lambda divided v is the mean time between collisions. We call this the drift speed v sub d. So that next formula. If n, small n is the number of the conduction electrons per unit volume, and j is the current density, we have v sub d equals j divided small n multiplied e equals e multiplied e multiplied lambda divided m multiplied v. Combining this with the definition of resistivity, rho equals e divided j gives us formula first a. Equation first 1a can be taken as a statement that metals obey Ohm's law for the quantities v and lambda that determine the resistivity rho do not depend on the applied electric field, which is the criterion that the law is obeyed. Often we deal with the conductivity sigma formula 1b. This can be put in a more useful form by defining a measurable quantity, the mobility mu, of a magnitude given by the ratio of the draft speed to the applied electric field. It is mu equals formula 1c. Then, since sigma equals n multiplied e square multiplied a divided m multiplied v, we have mu equals a divided n multiplied e or sigma formula number 2. If we have conduction by positive carriers as well as negative carriers, the conductivity is given by sigma formula, in which mu sub n and mu sub p are the mobilities of the negative and positive carriers. Q sub n and Q sub p are their charges, and n and p are the numbers of these carriers per unit volume. If conduction is by negative charge carriers, the charge Q of the carrier is negative, whereas Q is positive if conduction is by positive carriers. Since the sign of the mu also depends on the sign of the Q, which term is expression for sigma is always positive. The sign of the charge carrier of electric current in a metal can be determined from measurement of Hall effect. That is, when a current carrying conducting sheet is placed perpendicular to the magnetic field, an electric field is set up perpendicular both to the magnetic field and the flow of the current. By measuring the potential difference between the two surfaces of the conductor, it is possible to deduce the sign and value of the quantity 1 divided n multiplied Q, called the Hall coefficient. Here, n is the number of the charge carriers per unit volume, and Q is the charge of the carrier. The electric field arises from an accumulation of charge carriers on one surface due to the V sub d multiplied B force exerted on them when they move with velocity V sub d through the magnetic field B. In some metals, as zinc and beryllium, for example, the Hall effect indicates net positive charge carriers. This is interpreted as being due to the transition of electrons from the filled valence band to the conduction band, leaving holes, unoccupied energy levels, in the valence band. Such holes correspond to the absence of the electron and behave much like positive charges. As these vacancies are filled by electrons moving under the influence of the electric field, the holes move in a direction opposite to the electrons, just as so positive charge carriers were moving in the field direction. In this case, the metals with the s2 atomic configuration, such as zinc and beryllium, the mobility of s-band holes is much greater than the p-band electrons. Since the sign of the Hall coefficient depends on which type of the carrier has the higher mobility, the Hall coefficient is positive for these metals. In table, we list the Hall coefficients of some metals and also the number of free electrons per atom. The latter is computed from the value of the Hall coefficient 1 divided n multiplied Q and the density of the metal. For the alkalis and other monovalent metals, Hall measurements agree with the 1 conduction electron per atom. Of course, the free electron model on which the simple Hall effect analysis is based is not expected to be valid for all atoms, all metals. In quantum theory and the Fermi distribution to conduction electrons in metal, the potential in which the electron moves can be appropriated by a rectangular potential well. This constant potential smooths out the actual periodic variation due to the ion cores and includes the average effect of all the remaining electrons. It is equivalent to treating the electrons as an ideal gas or fermions inside the solid. This approximation, which greatly simplifies quantum mechanical calculations, turns out to be surprisingly good in determining many of the observed properties of solids, such as contact potential and electronic specifiers heats. We can use the result for the distribution with energy of free conduction electrons in the metal, namely Formula 3. On the left side of figure 4, it is shown the prediction of Formula 3 for the absolute zero temperature energy distribution of electrons in a partly filled band, with energy being measured from the lowest energy in the band. The maximum energy allowed in the band is epsilon sub max and epsilon sub f less than epsilon sub max, as shown in that figure. At temperature greater than zero, the uppermost electrons are excited to occupy nearby available higher states, and the distribution function makes the forms shown on the right side of the figure 4. The number of quantum states in the energy interval epsilon to epsilon plus d epsilon in the factor n function from epsilon multiplied d epsilon of formula 3, namely formula 4. In figure 4, n functions from epsilon is shown by a dashed curve and for unit volume in density of states. The dash dot curve is smaller n function from epsilon, the Fermi distribution for the number of electrons per state. The solid curve gives the product n small function from epsilon multiplied n function from epsilon, the energy distribution of electrons or number of electrons per unit energy interval. The Fermi energy equals formula 5. Now we shall use the free electron model to evaluate the width in energy of a band for the simple case of a one-dimensional metal. The engine functions for an electron in the deep square well, representing the smoothed out in attraction of the ion cores distributed in uniformly along the x-axis plus the average repulsion of the remaining electrons are essentially sinusoidal standing waves-like. Formula 6, where lambda is the wavelength and k equals 2 multiplied p divided lambda is the wave number. The eigen functions have nodes and each end of the wells, since their values to go to the zero outside the well. These boundary conditions led immediately to the requirement that n multiplied lambda divided 2 equals L, where L is the length of the well. Each value of the integer n equals 1, 2, 3, etc. corresponds to a different energy function or energy level if we allow two electrons on opposite spin pair level. Since for free electrons the energy is epsilon equals h square multiplied n square divided 8 multiplied m multiplied l square, the minimum value of n corresponds to the level of essentially zero energy at the bottom of the band, and the maximum value of n corresponds to the level of the maximum energy at the top, the width of the band being approximately equal to that maximum energy. If there are n ions, each separated by distance a in the one-dimensional metal of length L, then n equals L divided A. As we have explained before, the number of levels in the band is just equal to n, so the maximum value of the n small will also be equal to n. Thus the maximum energy or energy width of the band of our dimensional metal is formula 7. This result, which depends on n, on A, but is independent of n, confirms the statement made earlier that the width of a band depends on the separation of the ions and not on the number of the ions in the lattice. The free electron model gives very good results for many metals. It is especially good for the alkali metals, where the overlap of bands, as in figure 3 for sodium, is so complete that the density of states n function from epsilon behaves like the curves of figure 4. The epsilon square dependence of n function epsilon on epsilon is not correct, however, in the case of the isolated band. Also, the actual shape of the curve of density of states depends on the position of the band and the structure of the lattice. Its shape is roughly symmetric, as shown in the upper part of the figure 5, in that it decreases to zero at the top of the band. To understand how this comes about, consider a one-dimensional crystal, which is so long that we first ignore the boundary conditions and it ends. Then the most convenient energy functions for the free electron are sinusoidal traveling wave length, formula 8, where the forms are positive or negative exponents describe an electron moving on the positive or negative direction of the x-axis. It is even more convenient to take only the form psi and let k by either positive or negative. Now we write the energy epsilon of a free electron in terms of its wave number k equals p divided h bar, where p it is a momentum, that is formula 9.